Hello, this is Dr. David Cruz of Web Exercises, and thank you for joining us this week for our webinar. Today we are going to be talking about instrument-assisted soft tissue mobilization, so thank you for joining us. It's our mission at Web Exercises to really make it easy to create, share, track, and manage exercise programs for your patients and clients. So we always like doing webinars which are complementary, that help really give clinicians the tools and understandings to make an impact with their patients and clients. And as I mentioned earlier, it's a great webinar we have lined up today for instrument-assisted soft tissue brought to you by RockTape. Instrument-assisted soft tissue is becoming such a mainstay with treatment nowadays. I know clinically, I practiced for about close to 20 years, and really at that time, there wasn't a lot out there. And in the past few years, really the evidence is coming out on how beneficial it is, and it's great as a complement to your active care and exercise program. So we're really looking forward to today's webinar. And as mentioned, as previously on other webinars, if you've been here in the past, there's an opportunity to ask some questions. At the end, you'll see in the GoToWebinar widget panel, there's a spot where you can type questions. So go ahead, type those in as things come up, and I'll be back on after the presentation to moderate those with the presenter. And we always have a special offer at the end. It's usually a one-day, two-day special, so hang tight for that from RockTape as well as from Web Exercises. So I'd like to introduce a good friend of mine. He is the education director for RockTape. Dr. K, we will call him Dr. Chrisworth. I've known him for about 2 years now. Really sharp guy with regards to his background. He got his undergraduate in athletic training from Cal State Dominguez Hills. He went on to pursue his PhD in athletic training from Rocky Mountain University. He's also the director of sports medicine for Chrisworth Sports Medicine System. As part of his graduate degree, he did his dissertation on biomechanics as well as Brazilian jiu-jitsu injuries. So he's just a really great speaker, knows a ton of information on this, and is really, I love him because he's a great hands-on clinical guy as well, likes getting his hands in, so he's one of us, likes really working with people. And that's what he does with his sports training systems as well. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce my good friend, Dr. K. Welcome to our webinar series, and I will let you take it away from here.
Wow. Thanks, Dave, for that incredible introduction there. I guess we are pretty good friends now, a couple of years, so appreciate that. And I do appreciate the relationship between Web Exercises and RockTape and what we do together. So great things to come. Hopefully we could do more webinars like this. So today I really want to talk about instrument-assisted soft tissue mobilization, and that acronym has been out there for quite some time with the advent of tools, whether those tools were gua sha tools, bull bone, or plastic tools, all the way to other types of tools that are now out there. We really want to think about what's going on right now with tooling and manual therapy, and what are we really doing? The research doesn't dive deep into, are there actual crazy mechanical changes of tissue compared to what are we doing potentially neurosensory-wise to the nervous system. So we'd like to think about this idea of instrument-assisted neurosensory modulation. Again, instrument-assisted neurosensory modulation, and we'd like to think about changing the system, whether it's increasing sympathetic tone or decreasing sympathetic tone based on some stroke rates and some depths using a tool. So here I'm showing you a sneak peek of our tools. I'll run it one more time. We do have something called the mullet and the mallet. The mallet is our metal tool. It has multiple edges and has multiple curves, what, some concave, some convex, and you know, we think the tool is just a tool. We like to think about tools as just an extension of our hands. What are we truly doing to the system? So when we first came out with our tools, many people had questions on, you know, is it double beveled? Is it single beveled? Is it sharper on one side? Is it convex? Is it concave? What are you trying to do with the tool? And, you know, again, it's just a tool. It's all about what are we trying to achieve with the tool? We like to think of this idea of graded exposure. How are we treating the nervous system or the neurosensory system with taking a tool and applying it to skin? And at what rate and at what depth and at what angle, at what vector can help us have some possible positive outcomes to the patient with not killing tissue with a sharper edge? And I'll get deeper into that in a second. We love this slide. You know, when you understand a technique, you know a technique. When you understand a concept, you know 1,000 techniques. And that's truly the way we like to teach RockTape and RockBlades. Even with our taping courses, we use the same concept. We think about the big funnel. Big concepts in the beginning and narrowing it down, getting specific to a potential area that you need to treat. So when you understand just a technique, you understand what to do with the plantar fascia, the Achilles tendon, the gastroc, the hamstrings, the low back, mid back, shoulder, whatever you want to talk about through the regional independence idea. But we like to think about what are we doing to the entire tissue? How are we treating the nervous system, the brain, with various strokes, rates, and depths? So really, our course is more related to understanding broader concepts on how you're trying to achieve best patient outcomes instead of thinking, hey, I'm going to treat the Achilles tendon for this itis, osteitis, or opathy issue and other tendons. So it's not as myopic. It's much more broader based. So what do we think we're doing right now? The research out there is vague. Upon what are we actually doing to tissue? Is fascial tissue actually mechanically changing when we take a tool and induce it into the skin and the fascia? Are we changing structure? And, you know, there's better research out there. There's current research out there by some very smart people, Dr. Robert Schleip and Dr. Bove and some other people that are saying we may not be changing mechanically tissue. So what are we doing to the system? We believe it's more sensory motor training. We believe that inducing stimulus via a tool can help upregulate or downregulate the nervous system to get a better motor system response. When we think about tissue itself, we think about tissue being rather compliant or rather stiff. We know that tissue, in order to get through movement, you have to have the stability within your system. But you also have to have the mobility within the skin and the fascia to move through that type of movement. So we call it elastic recoil or stiffness or compliance to get optimal efficiency out of the body. When joints are more not optimally aligned, you don't have that good joint centration, that good length tension relationships between tissue, we know that the feedback system or the feedback loop isn't going to be as optimal as far as its output. So it's up to us to try to change that. And do we change that mechanically or do we change that neurosensory? We feel it's both. We feel it's both. I love this slide, and that's why I put it in here. Is again, this is pulling out of Robert Schleip's work, but healthy, it's all about healthy tissue. So we know that muscles are rather dumb. They take a lot of oxygen. They're not very smart. When we think about fascia as a Cinderella tissue, as Schleicher calls it, we think about this healthy, movable tissue that glides and slides throughout the body. And when we don't have that gliding and sliding of the body, then we have unhealthy tissue and potentially lack of slide and lack of glide. And we have lack of slide and lack of glide, we don't have the optimal body positions to put ourselves into. And or we can't respond to optimal positions in order to get into them, just with daily adult living. If I have to reach up for something on top of the shelf and I don't slide and glide correctly within my fascial tissue, subsequently I may have a back injury or a knee injury, and it may not be that fault. It may just be the lack of the slide and the glide of the tissue. So understanding how to assess that within this course and understanding how to treat that and then understanding how to reassess is a good tool to have to understand this idea of glide and slide. So here we have young, healthy tissue. This kind of lattice-looking effect, this matrix-looking effect that glides and slides throughout the body as somebody goes through plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. Or we have more of a poor tissue quality, and this is what happens to tissue as it just starts to mat down. When you don't have this this slide and glide, this buoyant type of movement daily, whether it's just some walking and some running or jumping jacks, things that are rather ballistic, then tissues may mat down. And I like to make the analogy that this looks like a dreadlock, like tissues, just like hair. If you don't wash it and comb through it daily, it may just stick together and become one big dreadlock. If that happens, then things are going to be stuck. If things get stuck in one area, then issues may occur above or below that area. So again, just communicating the idea that tissues need to be rather elastic and then need to have this kind of elastic recoil, this catapult effect. Schleich did some very interesting research looking at these catapult effects of tissue, of how we can make tissue elongate and then spring back, almost similar to like a kangaroo. A kangaroo truly doesn't have the hypertrophy to be so strong within this movement, but it's very, very bouncy. A kangaroo can jump very high. It's very quick in its movements, and that's not because of muscles. That's because of this tissue that's sliding and gliding throughout the body. So it's the tissue that's actually probably smarter than the muscles. Another component that we're looking at today is more along the lines of biopsychosocial research. Biopsychosocial research is becoming more paramount within the information today regarding persistent pain. So we're trying to get away from the term chronic pain, because that's even a negative term for some people, chronic pain. And when people are in pain, it adds to the feedback loop of pain. People become more sensitive to pain. It's that pain loop. So educating your patient on what's going on in their system, educating them on the ideas of what may be causing pain. And for years and years, and still today's mechanical model, the ideas that are being taught that cause pain are mainly mechanical. For instance, we have people coming in getting MRIs and they may have a disc bulge and they're being in pain. But then comparative studies are showing that people with the same types of disc bulge in the same area have no pain. That tells us a lot about human behavior and its experiences with pain. So when people get caught in these pain loops, then they stay in chronic or persistent pain. And it's up to us as clinicians and within this course is to educate people on how we can better achieve the idea of pain and mitigate pain through a thought process as well as treatment. So this is a great slide. Dr. Steve Capobianco created this slide looking at, say, release again, I dare you. The term release within soft tissue work has been out there for quite some time. And what we're seeing now is we don't know if we're actually releasing tissue. And that's a very interesting concept because many people will come to the course and say, well, I just released the psoas, I just released the piriformis, look at its change, and show a pretest, post-test type of design or outcome. And we say that is great and we're happy with outcomes, but if a change happened that quickly, could it truly be a tissue mechanical response? Did the tissue actually release that quickly? And in Dr. Bove's eyes, we're creating this idea of glide, where maybe we broke up or we treated some immature adhesions or some lack of glide to get this tissue to respond that quickly. And or conversely, did we treat the nervous system, downregulate the nervous system, or add some stability somewhere in the nervous system to create this movement that quickly? And that's the neuro side. So you're looking at two major components here. You're looking at the neuro side, what kind of changes occurred within the patient and your hand or your tool, and then also mechanically what occurred between you and your patient, your hand and your tool. So it's both. Again, just pulling from Dr. Schleich's research is some really interesting stuff. Within his research, he's debunking the idea that fascial release actually occurs. It's very hard, according to him, to change the mechanical deformation of fascia. He dismissed these traditional ideas of fascial toughness, and he concluded that it may be actually impossible to conceive to actually change fascia mechanically. So are we doing this? Are we having this, you know, when we go in to see our massage therapist, our chiropractor, our physical therapist, our athletic trainer, whoever's doing our tissue work on us, are we actually making all this mechanical change? Is it occurring? And here's the strange part is that many, if we're treating athletes, many of these athletes want this deep, heavy, sedative type of massage. maybe not our geriatric patients and definitely not our pediatric patients, but some people just crave this, that type A behavior. They have to have it in order to make a change. And again, it's up to us to educate that person and that athlete or that patient on, are these changes occurring what we think they are changing, we think they're changing? Are we really making these mechanical changes? And again, if that's what they want out of it, then that's great. But we know, at least through this course, we know the research is suggesting a little bit more neurosensory. So great quote here by Dr. Robert Schleif is, how much pressure is truly necessary to distort tissue? Roughly 2,000 pounds per square inch. That's astronomical. And maybe in 5 years, we'll see this number change, and maybe we'll be completely wrong. But currently, what's showing through some electron microscope technology, what's showing through some histological studies, is that it takes a heck of a lot of pressure. You would have to park a F Ford 150 on your back and hit reverse to get some thoracolumbar, thoracofascial lumbar changes on your back, potentially. That's a joke. Don't do that. But the idea is that, you know, are we really making these mechanical changes through tissue? So our old school thought, you know, tells us that aggressive and intense manual therapy with regard for the state of patient service system may be problematic, and that's what we're seeing today. Again, many of our patients, our clients, crave this type of technique, and they feel this is the way they're going to get their output. And this whole no pain, no gain idea, I think that we can revert and look at something more along the lines of graded exposure. Graded exposure is a term that Lowermeer, Mosley, and Butler use within the biopsychosocial research to actually change behavior. We think we can use it as far as changing behavior with regard to the tools. Many athletes have a hard time with this, or many patients have a hard time with this, trying to change a person through soft changes. But potentially, with education, we can make these. So again, neurological effects potentially are what's actually occurring here within the system, and not so much these quick mechanical changes of release. Dr. Capobianco is one great artist. He created this slide trying to illuminate the idea that there's two sides of the brain. There's a reptilian side, and then there's a neocortex side. And what's interesting about this rendition of artistry is that through tactile sense, through the awareness of information to the skin and to its fascia, we may be able to mitigate pain, downregulate the nervous system, and or upregulate the nervous system. There's areas, and I'm going to show you some interesting research, there's areas of patients that may have chronic pain that have lack of sensitization in certain areas, specifically OA of the knee and chronic low back pain patients. So mitigating pain through some lighter strokes, as light as feathering, believe it or not, interesting research has suggested that strokes with cotton balls and strokes with painter's brushes that are used for treating pediatric OT patients have good outcomes to downregulate the nervous system. So the idea of the frog is more of the reptilian brain. And what we're trying to suggest here is that when people are in chronic pain or when people are in a persistent pain, they are on threat. And Mosley talks a lot about threat of the brain. When you're actually on threat because you're in pain, you really can't move or have any forethought or some critical thought regarding movement. So it's hard for us to get to the cortex, to the neocortex, to a movement-based type of exercise program. So we need to mitigate pain. And we can mitigate pain through distraction techniques such as icing and stim and heat and all those other type of passive modalities. And or we can use it with some tooling effects, these feathering effects, so these lighter effects to mitigate the pain and start changing motor output. Just some quick treatment along certain areas to change the motor output. Because really, movement is going to be the medicine for the brain, and that's what we want to get. We need to get past this idea that passive modalities are doing long-term changes to our patient. We don't see that. Movement is doing long-term, great long-term outcomes to our patients. So with the advent of using tools and various stroke rates, it's a great idea to mitigate pain and to get past this idea of threat. And threat is a big thing. I say threat and pain go hand in hand, and it's up to us as clinicians to mitigate that or downregulate that. So information coming into the skin, changing it. And the way this is done is actually through Hilton's law. Previously, we would always think about mechanoreceptors and proprioceptors being deep within the joint and maybe even the tendon, the Golgi tendon. But now we're seeing through the research is that these nerve root supplies and mechanoreceptor are actually found in skin and fascia as well as the joint. So that gives us a lot of information that, hey, putting your hands on somebody or tooling somebody at various stroke rate or depth or vector can actually change the person's perception around that area. We never thought that before. And that's some incredible new research coming out from STECO. We like to call it precision training. And we think that applying some stroke rates or some tooling techniques to improve the cortical map and improve motor control. And when we talk about the cortical map, we're talking about our skin and our fascia. What is our awareness of space? What is our awareness of that joint and its position sense? Not so much deep within the joint, but the skin, the sock that's surrounding the joint or the skin that's surrounding the joint to give us more information. So body mapping or cortical mapping is a relatively new idea that we're using within our RockBlades course. And just to share some of these research articles, within the course we do cover this a lot, but we talk about this idea of tactile acuity disruption and what happens in people that may have chronic arthritis, what's going on with their motor imagery, what's going on with their pain. And what we've seen through some of that research is that people that are that have osteoarthritis have much wider two-point discrimination testing. If you did a two-point discrimination wheel, much wider variance within touch sensation, maybe even something called graphesthesia, where you're writing letters on somebody's back. Here I am showing another article related to the same topic, tactile thresholds. But what we see is that people have less sensory perception in persistent pain areas, chronic low back pain, osteoarthritis. These people just don't have the necessary awareness around that area, and that's problematic because then they lack the awareness of spatial awareness within their movement gait. So again, further communicating the idea that shouting to the brain, talking to the brain through the skin may have good outcomes related to your patients. So not so much treating muscles, but treating skin and fascia to help up or down regulate the nervous system. So again, I talked about this idea of mechanical and sensory, but most of us know who Moshe Feldenkrais is. He's paramount within the field of motor influence and posture, but he thought the nervous system was probably the most important target for influencing posture and movement. And then conversely, you have Ida Rolf, the famous Ida Rolf, who talks about fascia and has treated fascia with many people and taught her system, saying fascia is the most important tissue for posture and movement. And again, one's mechanical and one's neuro, so we think if we can communicate both, we'd have pretty good outcomes. Not to get too deep into the neuroscience, but it's interesting to show that, you know, depending on what you want to do to the nervous system, you may be able to excite those tissues. And we're here we talk about the four types of fascial receptors, and we primarily stick to these ideas of upregulating and downregulating through Pacinian corpuscles and Ruffini nerve endings. So these types of mechanoreceptors are sensitive to certain types of pressure and sense and vibration. And if I talk about Pacini corpuscles, where people lack the awareness of a perception, such as I showed you in those articles with OA and low back pain, these are areas that may need some stability in the system. So we would actually take our tool and we'd show you a technique to actually increase awareness around there. And then after we'd increase that awareness, we may do a post-test. Maybe that's a toe touch, maybe that's a squat, maybe that's some rotation, whatever the case may be. And then we'd apply some rock tape on there to hold on to those newfound changes. So the idea of firing up the body in certain stroke rates is possible. And then conversely, we have, you know, Ruffini nerve endings, which may be responsible for relaxation of the tissue. We know that sustained pressure, and we would say that most people seek this type of therapy. People don't know about feathering techniques to mitigate pain. They don't know about Pacini techniques to increase awareness of the nervous system, and they may just know a lot more about this slow, sustained pressure. And I think when I've taught this class multiple times, the first two concepts of feathering for interstitial work, for pain mitigation and or for treating areas of awareness, is relatively new for most people, and I think practicing these ideas has a good output on the system. Most people, I would say, come to the course to learn about the Ruffini, the sustained pressure, because they think we're going to take the tool and just grind and kill tissue. And that's really what we want to avoid. We want to avoid this idea of extreme pressure into the tissue to make our patient wince in pain, to create this idea of petechiae causing bleeding within the tissue. These are other techniques that we just don't abide by and we don't use because we feel that we can have outcomes related to a more graded exposure, something a little bit less. And we use fascia as our roadmap. We know that force occurs along these lines of fascia, and we'll be able to treat them, whether it's neuro or whether it's mechanical, to get some better outcomes with our patient. Most of us have seen a slide like this because we know the majority of our tissue is all connected. It's hard to say that, you know, there's a disconnect between your ankle, knee, hip, low back, mid back, shoulder, neck, when we know that these fascial lines kind of all connect. And that's through the idea of Thomas Meyer's work, Schleich's work, Stecco's work, all these great people that are studying anatomy these days. That's not to discount that there are areas of mobility and stability within the body. So within our course, we take this approach. We kind of go through a divided highway. We talk about the idea of the joint by joint and what areas need stability and what areas need mobility and how we can affect that with our tools. And then we also talk about fascia as our highway. How can we create some information to our fascia, which will lead to information to our brain? Typically, what we've seen in the past is a little bit more myopic view of treating an injury for an injury and being myopic. I know as an athletic trainer in the early days, if you had a rotator cuff issue or some type of impingement issue, that's what you would treat. You wouldn't look above and below the regional independence idea. You wouldn't look what fascia does to the body and is it gliding and sliding through an assessment. You would just look at one muscle, one tendon, its nerve supply, and its vascular supplies and just worry about that. So I think today, through the advent of many courses and research, we're seeing that this idea of regional independence is becoming paramount within the research and within practice, so we can't discount it. Looking at these long lines of tissue and understanding how they connect and how they change a body's posture and its awareness is important for treatment and its outcomes. So again, Ida Rolf, you know, she said it best, where it is, where it ain't, and within our coursework, even within our taping course and our tooling courses, we always use these concepts to think that, hey, we need to understand what's going on above and below, because if things are changing above and below, that may be affecting what's in between. We see this a lot with knee injuries. We see it a lot with back injuries, with shoulder injuries, and up and down the chain. So understanding these concepts and how to treat these concepts is important for patient outcomes. With tooling, we do it relatively the same. With tooling, we say, okay, hey, let's look at, you know, let's look at hip pain. What's going on with hip pain? And is the hip moving adequately? Is it seeking stability? Is it seeking mobility? And within our class, we talk about that. And then if we don't get the outcomes we want to, well, did we treat the fascial chains above and below? So the same idea, joint by joint, but also the fascial system too. So if I'm looking at this posterior line right here, and somebody has some hamstring pain, am I treating hamstring, but am I also treating gastroc tissue and maybe paraspinal tissue? I can go that far apart. Opposingly, if I'm looking at the functional line and somebody has hip pain, am I treating lateral thigh tissue, hamstring tissue, and also opposing lat tissue or thoracolumbar tissue? So I like to tell people within the course that I'm going to show you tooling techniques to mitigate pain, to increase sensory awareness, and or maybe to actually make mechanical changes. But if you don't get your changes, let's readdress. Let's talk about these fascial lines and see if we could input more information, whether that's upregulate or downregulate, to the tissues above and below along the fascial lines. Dr. Capobianco had some really good information looking at diagnostic ultrasound. He likes to play with diagnostic ultrasound a lot. And I think some of these slides really bring home what's going on underneath the skin. As we just look at this slide, just as a direct anatomy slide, you're looking at dermis and epidermis. And what connects all these guys are these little tiny things called skin ligaments. They could be called reticular cutis superficialis, if you want a very direct term, and or profundus. So all these types of tissues are actually held together by these tiny, tiny little skin twigs or skin ligaments, whatever you want to call them. And they create tension within the layers of tissue. So you have dermis, you have superficial fascial lines, you have some deeper muscle and all this intramuscular fascia, and then bone. And what we see is that when we tool somebody there where it says pre-blades, if you look at that one fuzzy little part there within the middle of the slide, that may be a pathological scar. If we see a pathological scar, can we have it influenced with some tooling techniques? So you see this pathological scar, that fuzzy right in the middle of the center of the screen at the pre-blades slide, where it's actually inducing some influence into some fascial tissue. And after we tool that post-blades, running the ultrasound head over the same area, you see that that tissue may be lessened and not influencing the fascial system as much or the fascial tissue as much. So these are some ideas that we use in class to actually change tissue and actually create some mechanical changes within the system. Now, I discussed earlier about this idea of biopsychosocial models, and we're trying to, as a system and as a company, trying to acknowledge that there's a lot more going on out there. It's not just mechanical. And Mosler and Butler truly talked about this idea of graded exposure and tissue tolerance. And what we've seen through the years of tools, we've seen that people tend to press really hard and cause this idea of petechiae on the skin to help with inflammation, actually increase the inflammation process and take out some waste products and help with healing faster. And what we're saying is that although those ideas may be true as well, we think that there may be a biopsychosocial component. So we actually go a little bit less and use education and not kill tissue. Because if you kill tissue every time, that means they can't be treated as much. So if somebody has a very large petechiae over, let's say, their thigh because you treated them, then you may not be able to go with that tissue the next day. You may have to wait a few days. So increasing this idea of tissue tolerance and feeding the brain, getting more sensory nervous system input to have a better output. Just to talk about our tools a little bit more, because that's kind of the foundation that I just gave you of how our classes are run, this idea of neuroscience and biopsychosocial instead of the mechanical model. But when we look at the tool itself, you know, many people have questions about the edges. And again, we didn't put tons of thought into all these edges because we truly think it's the education and the neuroscience that we're trying to convey. But we do like to have fun with tools. Obviously, you see on our mullet tool, our black tool, we made some fun names, hard rock, soft rock. We actually even put a bottle opener on there because at RockTape, we don't take ourselves too seriously, so we like to have some fun. You could use that for some bowler plate work with your finger if you wanted to. But it's a bottle opener, and we think that's just cool. So we have groovy rock, we have alternative rock, and then on our other side, we have our heavier tool, which is our stainless steel tool, where we have all these finger pads. And I think I have a picture of various grips. Depending on the size of your hand and where you're going to be storing these tools, like I said earlier, the polymer tool or mullet tool is a great tool to just keep really quickly in your back pocket if you're treating people multiple times. Do a treatment, clean it really well, put it back in your pocket. Our heavier tool has some weight behind it, and you can put some force behind it. So if you're truly trying to make some dry gliding changes, such as Bob suggested, truly increasing its glide, then maybe the heavier tool is your tool of choice. But you see all those finger pads on there. That means that we can hold a tool in almost about 8 different positions on each side. Some pads, depending on the type of tissue you're treating, quad, low back, hamstring. You use a convex side. The convex side introduces a lot of stimulus into the system. So I tell people to go easy, the graded exposure idea, go easy. And then you can go harder and harder as you wish, as long as you're not causing that petechiae effect. As far as some of the emollient that we're using out there, we like to use our rock rub. It's unscented. It's thick. Its viscosity is thick. So it just takes just a dab to put over an area, and it can go multiple times, multiple uses. Really quickly, again, less is more, and that's what we're trying to convey with the population out there as far as the sports medicine population and its associations out there, is less is more. So a 90-degree push on a thigh is very direct and pretty hard. Here's 45 degrees. This is the angle that we like to treat, if not 30 degrees, because 30 degrees is inducing some inflammation to your nervous system. And we could go fast right here. We can go very slow. We could go deeper. It all depends on what we're trying to do. And that's what we're trying to communicate, is what we're trying to do is really the main outcome. It's not about the tool. It's more about what we're trying to do with the patient. As far as effects, mitigation of pain, of course, is a big one. Causing relaxation, not to just that tissue, but the nervous system. Increasing some tactile acuity, like I spoke about earlier, patients that have knee pain and or low back pain chronically may lack some tactile awareness and tactile acuity in that area, believe it or not. So less is more. You can always go harder. We just suggest that you try a little bit lighter to see if you get some outcomes along with some education. And then if you truly want to go hard into tissue, trying to increase this glide effect because you feel through your assessment that the tissue does lack glide, then you could go into more of a mechanical theory of increasing slide and glide. And we do that with actually a dry technique. And our dry technique is not using any emollients, and we'll take the tool at a various angle and depth, and we'll drag it along the system or drag it along the tissue to increase some glide. And the only way we know that is post-testing. Does it look like it moved better? So again, this idea of petechiae over an area we feel is not as necessary as it is to mitigate pain and increase fascial gliding amongst the system. So how are we doing on time, Dave?
Looks you're still good. Keep rolling. I know you have a bunch of slides still to go. I would say, yeah, keep rolling. We're good. I'll give you kind of a heads up. Love it so far. Love Steve's drawing, I should say, earlier on on the primitive brain. So it's good. Steve is a great speaker and lecturer and a super smart guy, because I don't know what he has really with regards to a career with as being an artist, I'll say. And I say that because Steve's a great guy. I'll let you continue.
So this idea that we're trying to communicate is, How do we mitigate pain? And, you know, harder techniques seem to induce pain. And this idea of pain may be more mitigated through very light touch. And we know through some of the research, this is a quite heady slide, but if we look at the information coming into the skin, that 40% of interstitial tissues and these free nerve endings are low threshold, and they're responsive to very light touch, which is almost light as a cotton ball or a painter's brush. Some OTs out there use like these very soft nail brushes to actually cause some inflammation into the skin to actually mitigate pain, believe it or not. And we take our tools and we use an edge and we go roughly about 30 degrees and we'll go extremely fast and very, very light. And we'll do some pre-test, post-test to see if we actually mitigate pain. So if somebody is coming into you with pain, then it would be smart to mitigate their pain softly first before you go ahead and take a tool and cause them to sweat on the table, cause their eyes to dilate heavy, cause them to feel nauseousness, all types of signs and symptoms that may be caused from overtraining the nervous system. And, you know, for years I'll say that I've taken tools and I've induced so much pain for people that are already in pain, it just doesn't make any sense. You know, taking a bunch of tools and rolling them out in front of your patient and scaring them may not be the best tactic out there to actually get the outcome you want. What I do with tools is I'll take a tool, the RockBlades tool, and I'll let the patient hold it. I'll let them touch it. I'll let them become aware of it, check the edges, and then I'll communicate the idea that I'm going to mitigate your pain or downregulate your pain through this type of stroke, and I'll show it on their hand or their palm so they relax. Because, again, these patients that are coming to you are roughly in pain. Why do we want to put them face down and take a tool and drive it into their QL or their low back tissue and say, how you doing? It just doesn't make any sense to me. I don't think it makes any sense to the RockTape team to kill people's tissue and not let people be aware of what you're going to do to them. So I've taken 10 steps back from my original treatment ideas and helped with education, taking these tools, letting people touch it and understand it to control their awareness and to take them off threat before I do lay them prone and start working on tissue. And if I can say anything within this coursework, is this is the primary outcome I'm trying to achieve, relaxation and understanding and awareness of what we're trying to do to their tissue. So I talked about some of these autonomic nervous system changes. We have these chemical mediators that may have heavy influences on tissue tonus. It's not just the tissue's fault. Something is driving the tissue response. And whether those are chemical mediators related to stress, whether those are chemical mediators related to something else, we need to change that. And it may not be driven through heavy, heavy pressure. So taking a tool as light as this and feathering certain areas to mitigate pain, giving them some ideas of education, and then we can go deeper into the tissue if that's what we feel is necessary to make the outcome we want. But it shouldn't be the primary driver. So here is just some ideas of how we hold a tool for the feathering effect, very light. You can see the clinician's hand is very light on the tool, and we like to use this as examples to the patient so they feel at ease. Rates may be changing. Certain areas that need priming typically are areas that need stability in the system. So if we go back to the joint by joint approach, the idea, the knee, the low back, posterior shoulder, some areas may need more priming, more stimulation. So we can take this based on the research and we can increase their tactile acuity and their body representation in areas that need more information. Not everything is a mobility problem in the body. And I think after years of taking continuing education myself and manual therapy courses, it tends to seem that mobility is truly the culprit of all problems. And we're not seeing that, especially when we talk about the joint by joint and the regional interdependence approach. Some areas may need some tactile acuity. They may need more information to the system. And that's done by stimulating, actually, not by down-regulating the system with these slow, relaxing, hard pressure techniques. Here's a really good idea. This is more of just an analogy, but if I just talk about this idea of the global positioning system losing a signal, GPS system. If you lose your GPS system and you're driving, then you really lack your idea of where you are. The analogy is that's the same when somebody gets injured. We lack that awareness after an ankle sprain or after a knee injury of where we really are in relation to space. So that tissue may not need tons of hard manual therapy to start. It may need more positioning sense, awareness, and tactile acuity via the RockBlades tool to give us more information to that area so we can move on to a motor control program. These priming techniques are usually fast and oscillatory, and they're very quick. Just showing it through diagnostic ultrasound, you can see that what tissue looks like underneath the skin when you have this oscillatory effect. So we're truly not trying to change the mechanical deformation of tissue. We're just trying to invoke some information via the nervous system. So these are just some ideas that we use to show. And then within the coursework, we have multiple breakout sessions, and we show you how to use the tools, how to hold the tools, how to create this sense of being around the tool itself, and educating people. So Dave, I think we should go ahead and probably stop there. There's so much more to talk about, but this may be a good chance for people to, if they have any questions, to
Absolutely. There's a couple that have come through. One of them is, do you have a recommendation on when to do this as part of the treatment? So whether it's patient, athlete, you know, they might come in, you might have them do need some other passive, you know, treatment versus doing some of their rehab. So is there a certain time where you want to do this before, say, they do their exercise protocols or before another sort of treatment? I mean, can you give some thought on that, or does it matter from any perspective, from an outcome perspective?
Yeah, that's a great question. So typically, the RockTape instructors and I myself run along the ideas of the Panjabi model, and the Panjabi model would be more like, let's do our passive treatment first. So let's do our soft tissue work first to try to downregulate pain and invoke information to the nervous system. And then we can get into our active types of ideas, whether that's PNF or whether that's some active range of motion. And then we get into our more of our motor control. And typically we use that kind of three-dimension idea to our best patient outcomes. So the tooling would fit into the first paradigm of passive treatment. So for instance, if I had an athlete come in and they're having some Achilles tendinopathy, which is common, I may try to mitigate their tendinopathy pain by tooling back there with very light, fast strokes. And then I may do some isometric exercises after that, and then take them through some eccentric loading programs or eccentric concentric loading programs. So we feel the tool itself is a good way to start. And it may be day one. I've tooled people with acute ankle sprains. I've tooled people with acute shoulder sprains. And I didn't go killer into the tissue. I just feathered them to downregulate their pain. I taped them, and then I took them through some active range of motion and what they could do to tolerance, because our goal, our end result, is to get them to move better that day, not to just throw ice on them, heat on them, stim on them, and send them on their way. I want them to actually improve movement, which gives exercise to the brain, and that's what the brain needs.
Great. No, great answer. How about contraindications? I had a couple questions on that. Any sort of real contraindications for patients to be concerned about?
Great question. So I don't typically tool extremely hard over any hardware. I wouldn't tool directly extremely hard over any thrombuses. If you know that patient has a thrombus in that area based on some of their seeing their physician, I wouldn't tool directly over a thrombus. I'm still, I still haven't seen much of the research tooling over varicose veins. That's something we can look further into. But other than that, as long as I'm not inducing too much pressure, again, this is more neuro, I think that the contraindications are rather small.
Got it. Kind of a follow-up question to that. We did a webinar on Parkinson's disease a couple weeks ago, and somebody's asking about that with regards to any specific contraindication as it relates to Parkinson's or other kind of more systemic diseases. Lena, you touched on that a little bit. Do you have anything kind of more specific to Parkinson's or similar disorders?
Well, what a great question. I don't have any information on that. I'd love to look at some of that research. I think that's a great question that I could pass along to Dr. Capobianco, our medical director, and maybe send back through you, or maybe even find that person's email if they want to leave it, because that's a very, very interesting question. And within our coursework, we do get some of these outlier questions. But again, I'll go back to our premise of thought. If we're trying to invoke information to the nervous system and I can control for some of these shakes, then maybe tooling over the area and make sure the area is safe as far as the skin conditions, then I can look to see if I have any outcomes. I probably wouldn't kill that tissue, but I probably can cause some relaxation within the tissue or maybe just various body parts to see if I have any nervous system response. And the way I think about it, too, is that many of these types of techniques are transient at best, meaning that we can tool over an area and get a response, but it's truly up to the nervous system to hold on to those changes via motor control to get long-lasting outcomes. So tooling in Parkinson's would be a awesome study. Get that person's information. Let's see if we can find that answer.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I mean, you made a comment earlier in there, I think, which is one I always remember when you said that movement is pretty much medicine for the brain, or I think you said it a little more eloquent. But I mean, it's you know, over and over again, we see that just how important that movement, that reinforcement, just like you're describing, and how important that is from a neuro perspective. And a question on kind of painful areas in that. Let's talk about that ankle sprain. So the question is about painful areas versus non-painful areas, duration, how much you're doing, how long do you treat certain areas. So say you got an athlete with a sprained ankle, over the more affected area, how long would you do that, time duration versus, you know, you're up in the gastroc or higher up in the leg where it's kind of a non-painful.
Right, great question. So what we're seeing through the research is that feather strokes that are quick and upwards of 30 seconds to tolerance, that means 30 seconds roughly two and a half minutes in one vector, is a good way to mitigate pain. So the way we teach it within the class is that we do these four vectors. Let's say we're over an ankle sprain, and again, anterolateral ankle sprain right around the lateral malleolus is a pretty you know, bony area to treat, but sidelie them, putting a pillow underneath their ankle, getting them as comfortable as possible, and then doing a vector like down directly over the area, directly over the swelling, believe it or not, very, very light, 30 seconds or to tolerance, then changing the vector, going up right over the area, then going medially and then laterally. So 30 seconds each stroke rate, and then we can move above and below along that fascial line. So that's pretty much the lateral line of the body, the lateral chain. So we can move up along the peroneals and feather in another area, or below downwards toward the foot, the dorsum of the foot, above and below, or over the dorsum of the foot. So trying to mitigate pain directly over the area in four vectors, 30 seconds at a time each vector, and then moving above and or below to see if I get better outcomes. And my outcome is only measured by the person and their subjective information. Did that feel better? And or movement. Maybe I do a quick little dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, inversion, eversion, and then reassess it after I do my tooling to see if I made some motor outcomes.
Got it. Great. Just a couple more, then we'll wrap it up. And this one has to do with a lot of different ASTM courses out there. Without getting into specifics of the different, companies that do this, can you talk about, you know, what makes RockBlades and RockTape unique? Maybe a couple key points and why, you know, why you guys are doing it differently. Why you guys rock.
That's a great question. I think most people come, we've been teaching this course since June now, and I think most people come to actually see, you know, what are you guys doing differently? Are we just another instrument-assisted course? And like I spoke about previously, is we feel we're bringing the cutting-edge neuroscience to the table, the tooling field. There's a lot of tools out there, a lot of tools to choose from, but we feel it's just a tool. There's nothing more than a piece of metal in your hand with multiple edges and bends and turns, and it's not about that tool. It's about the information that you're trying to provide to your patient and your patient outcomes. It's not all about mobility either. We at RockTape talk a lot about motor control and the movement-based paradigm that we're trying to achieve with our patients. Killing tissue, just mobility are... I won't say old school thoughts, but they're only one school of thoughts. We need to understand that the nervous system is controlling the majority of this type of tissue. Whether that tissue is under duress, whether that tissue is tight and facilitated, tight and inhibited, we need to understand the brain and the way we can tool the brain, believe it or not, through the skin. And that's what we're trying to do, is just further educate people that, hey, it's not just about a muscle, a tendon, and a ligament and its vascular supply. It's much broader than that. When you put your hands or a tool on somebody in various strokes, rates, and depths and vectors, you're going to get a output that may be more neurosensory than it is mechanical. And I think that's the biggest take home, is that here we are, another tooling company with a very different outlook on what we're trying to do to the patient based on the biopsychosocial research and also based on the neuroscience. It's not all about mobility.
Oh, that's great, great, great answer. And there's a question just regarding to some references. I will just forward that to you offline. And then I'm going to kind of close this up with, I think this is a great question, or I should say comment instead of a question, to end on. It says, I took the course in October and it was great, loving my RockBlades. So you guys are definitely doing something right, because somebody just put that comment in. And it ties into special offer. If you liked what you heard and you want to hear more, we have an exclusive offer to get 15% off the RockBlade course. So you can sit, listen to Ethan or one of their great instructors, go through a whole course on this and really become an expert, understanding their whole methodology, just like Ethan's been going through. And also with web exercises, we do a 48-hour special. With the movement as medicine for the brain, we have the full RockTape library that can be created and then shared with your patients, so you can do your correctives as part of web exercises, your blading, taping, and then corrective exercise, all part of the web exercises library. And then I wanted to mention our next webinar, Dr. Kyle Stoll of NASM. He's going to be going over their corrective exercise screen. So that's, we're really looking forward to that beginning of January. So I'd like to thank you, Ethan. Any last thoughts before I close this out?
No, I'm really happy that I got to communicate these ideas. And, you know, when you come to the course, if you do come to the course, we're a very affordable CEU out there. We like to have fun, and we like to have a more of a Socratic teaching method. People bring their ideas, and we're very open to everyone's ideas. Our idea is not the only idea. We love to share and share alike. And within the course, we teach you how to use a tool and why to use a tool and how to develop a program for using the tool. I think, you know, when you go to some other courses, you may just see how to do tooling in certain areas. We want to put together a program for you and show you why we're doing it. So thanks again, Dave. I really appreciate you giving me the opportunity and RockTape with web exercises. Thank you.
No, we really appreciate it and love working with you guys. You always bring some great content, and that's kind of what we like to do with these webinars, is just bring great speakers, great content, make better educated clinicians, and that's going to help with better outcomes. So I'm going to wish everybody a happy new year, happy holidays, and please join us the first week of January for our webinar on corrective exercise with Dr. Kyle Stoll from National Academy of Sports Medicine. Look forward to seeing everybody next year with our webinar series. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks, guys.